You should be warned, the upcoming episode will be full of unfiltered, off-the-cuff discussion. As such, you should consider this your spoiler warning.
Hello there, my name is Kyle.
And my name is Ryan.
And with our pals combined, we've all...
Experience Groundhog Pants.
Oh my God. Ah, the only podcast, or the podcast where we're not the only two white dudes with opinions on bullshit that doesn't matter.
Do you always want to do a drunk cast at this point?
But we're not the worst. This is like a half drunk cast. So in case you can't tell, listeners, hello everybody. This is the second episode we're recording tonight. Mm-hmm. And we're into the booze.
Yeah.
So, this is going to be our top games of 2016.
Favorite games.
I said that last time and you corrected me, and he's going to correct me again. Favorite. These were not maybe the most critically acclaimed, but these were our favorites that we played.
Mm-hmm. That we played. So it's going to be a smaller sample, too. So there's going to be a lot of games that we didn't get to play this year because we only have so much goddamn time being adults.
Games are a lot longer.
Yeah.
Similar to what we did last time, I don't have a poop list. I actually wrote the word blah above these two games that I've played, but they're kind of just eh.
I'm curious as to what they are. Go ahead.
So you're going to be happy with the first one, I think.
Oh, we'll see.
The Last Guardian.
Ha!
It's been a bit of a blah for me.
Fuck that game.
I don't know if it's a victim of overhyping by myself, which I have a bad tendency to do. Ask Nathan, frequent guest of the show. He will tell you I hype the shit out of everything.
Yeah.
I will buy into a lot of things. It's my own fault. It's a problem I have. Maybe I try to work on it in the year of improvement for 2017. I probably won't, but we'll see. But yeah.
Too bad Team Eco couldn't take a year of improvement and actually done something new instead of just rehashing old ideas.
They had 9 years of improvement.
Not evolving their gameplay.
I can't say for sure. I haven't completed it yet because I've been focused on other things. I will finish it, I'm sure. But
I have a feeling that once it ends and it's going to have like an ending like Shadow of Colossus, we're just be like, that's amazing. And it's going to, I think that's going to pepper how you view the whole game.
Maybe.
Once you get to the ending.
Maybe. We'll see. Then that's why it's kind of a blah, because it's not really a poop per se.
Sure.
But I don't, it's not.
So it's like a wet fart?
Yeah, maybe. It's just sort of an eh. It hasn't fully impacted me, and it's not something I'm looking forward to jumping back into.
Okay.
But so it's my eh. That's a shoulder shrug of indifference.
That makes me sad because I know how much you were looking forward to it. I don't take pleasure in the fact that you are not finding pleasure in this game.
Well, thanks, buddy.
I am legitimately sorry about that.
Okay.
That sucks.
Do you have a blah of anything? Anything that you played that was just sort of like, eh.
No. Yeah, it's when it comes to video games, I don't just consume everything I can. I kind of pick and choose what I want. So I kind of go in pretty well educated, and I think I know what I'm going to like, and that's usually what I get for the new year.
Okay, well then...
So go into yours, sir.
My only other blah of the year so far has been Battlefield 1.
Interesting.
I got Battlefield 1 based on a lot of people I work with were going to be getting it, and I was like, all right, cool, I'll get it. We can all play up and squad together. And that is kind of fun, but man, like... That fucking game just takes so long anyways. A multiplayer map will take like... Dude, there's some that go like 45 minutes or an hour. And that's my big problem with like League of Legends. It's like, that shit takes too long, dude. I don't have fucking time. Like, give me shit like a Titanfall game where it's like 15 minutes of super condensed fun action. I'm totally there. But like, Battlefield, I'm just... Ugh. And the story is just... I don't care. It's fucking World War One, and yet... Everybody and their brothers running around with fucking machine guns. I don't know, man.
I don't know how.
That's not the World War One I learned about in history in high school in Bedford, Indiana.
With Billy Bob and Joe Bob and Sue Bob all running out into the field with guns.
There's a whole lot of Bobs going on.
Bob's the last name. It's pretty current.
So, Common, I don't know. Those something. Are my two blahs, man. So you really didn't play anything this year that you weren't like overly impressed with?
No, everything I played, I liked. I really liked.
Well, good.
again, I only played 8 games that came out this year. I told you right before we recorded, played 63 games to completion, but most of them are older.
That's a hell of a move, dude. So yeah. I commend you on that. You put a lot more time on completing things than I did.
Sneak it in when I can. That's why I also play a lot less multiplayer games, and that's where the time goes.
Yeah, I do sink. Even still, man, it was like 2 years ago. I spent a lot of time on Destiny this year, I will fully admit. So
I wonder if the Rise of Iron will make your list like last year.
I'll go ahead
and
tell you no.
Okay. Interesting.
I've kind of reached my apex with Destiny, I think. I was playing it just last night, but that's because a buddy of mine who I haven't talked to forever recently picked it up, and I was like, yeah, fuck it, let's play. So, again, I think you do a similar thing where you play Call of Duty on the 360 with a buddy of yours just because it's what he wants to do. So.
Yeah, it's what he has. He has an update to the new systems, and it's a nice way to catch up. Though we get on there, we don't fucking talk about anything. We just shoot shit.
Yeah.
We shoot shit and shoot the shit and just talk about, like, I don't know, turds. Just talk about literal turds.
So you're literally shooting the shit about shit.
Yes.
So I don't know, man. Those were my blah games.
Okay.
I'm a little burned or bummed, I guess, more I should say, about them. So I'd really like to kind of get in what we have really enjoyed this year. And I'd like you to start off.
Okay.
This time with your number fives.
All right.
Do we want to make any wagers on coherence? You want to bet $1 again?
No, I guarantee we have at least one on the list that's the same.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right,
man. I think we both know what's going to be too.
I think I have an idea.
Yeah. It's just a matter of where it ends up on the list for us. That's the tricky thing.
All right. I'm going to guess it's your number 4.
Okay. I'm going to guess. See, I don't know what else on your list, so I'm going to guess number 3.
Okay.
All right.
I still don't know what we're talking about here. We have not discussed this list in advance.
We don't know.
I don't know if it's even the right fucking game. But I have a good idea, and it's going to be your number 4. But let's get into your number 5, first of all. All
right. So before I even begin, there will be a few at the end honorable mentions that didn't quite make my list.
Okay.
And I think there are
two very important
games that probably should be on my list.
I've
but
got two, actually. So
yeah, that's where I'm about at. Games that really connected, or games I really enjoyed that meant a lot for the medium that just didn't connect with me.
Okay.
My number 5 is kind of surprising. I'm not usually a fan of this genre. That is Forza Horizon 3.
Very nice. Okay.
It's a simulation car game, and I do not like simulation car games. Burnout is probably the last time I played a car racing game, and it's because it's arcadey. Instead of racing, you're focused on taking people out and making extraordinary crashes. That's fun to me. Forza Horizon 3, through some fucking witchcraft, has like entranced me. And it has its hooks in me. I think it's because of the customizability. Before you even start any race, there are sliders. And you get experience in each race. There's a slider for everything. Like how smart the other drivers are, how sharp the turns are, how the traction on your tires, if you see a line that tells you the best way to go, and taking it off, making the game harder for yourself, gives you more experience. So this caters to anyone. Me, I suck at car racing when it comes to simulation shit, so all my sliders are maxed out. I don't get all the experience, and that's fine because I'm having a hell of a time. I think during certain races, when the rain's coming down, you are not going above 25 miles an hour, and it is still exciting. And it shouldn't be, but it is. It is set in Australia, so you get the whole environments that are very unique and different, like the jungle parts, the desert parts, the mountainous, icy parts. They're all very, very different and unique. It's just so much fun, and it is one of the best car racing games, I would say, ever. And this is now up there with Burnout 3 for me. Okay. It's like top tier racing games.
The Forza series is Xbox exclusive.
Yes.
I do plan to get a one in the very near future.
I'm so excited.
I will absolutely be getting Forza because, unlike you, I am a massive fan of the simulation racing genre.
You're going to eat this shit up.
Well, I plan to. I've enjoyed it. I'm a giant fan of Gran Turismo.
Mm-hmm. One where you have to spend 3 hours getting a license before you even start driving. Fuck that. I'm out.
I pledged and I supported the early racing game Assetto Corsata, which is it's a computer-only racing simulator.
Not familiar with it.
For a long time, I was a moderator on r/rallysim, which was a Reddit simulation rally simulator.
Dude,
and
you're deep into it,
I ran the dirt rally section of that, and it was, man, I love simulation racing. I love racing in general. So I'm very glad that you're into that. So,
I am.
As you know, I like to play a lot of online multiplayer. I envision that being one that you and I get into.
I will say the other cool thing about this game, the entire game can be played online with friends.
That's tight.
Can have 8 people doing the same story modes and missions.
I like games that give you, I know exactly mm-hmm. what you're talking about, the racing line, and it shows you where to break.
Yeah.
I don't use those, but mm-hmm. that's it's a personal choice. And I like that is there for people because it levels a lot of the playing field. Mm-hmm. And eventually, over time, you can turn that off and you understand where curves and brakes are. So mm-hmm. fucking awesome.
It becomes, what, reflex memory and you get
Not
that
so
down.
Much. You actually get, if you use it, it's showing you where you're going to brake and where your apex turns mm-hmm. are and things. Mm-hmm. So it becomes a more natural thing. This is why I'm excited for our big trip we're going to be taking in March when we go go-kart racing. I fucking love racing. I love it, man.
I do too.
Yeah.
Oh, well, go-kart racing specifically. Like,
I'm just
I love
racing, racing in general, so I'm excited about this. So.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's my number 5. Kyle, what is your number 5?
Well, speaking of multiplayer games, my number 5 for the entire year is a multiplayer-only game. That would be Overwatch.
Yep.
Very, very, very fun, very unique team-based multiplayer first-person shooter.
Mm-hmm.
Every character has their own pros and cons, their own strengths and weaknesses, and it's about amassing. It's like a League of Legends, only in the first-person viewpoint. And I mean that in the fact that you have certain characters that are weak to other characters but are stronger against them, and it's about building the team based around that and making the changes you need to on the fly. Sometimes you can use the detriments to your character and making them a strength. Like, you know, they're maybe not so good at attacking, but if you can figure out a way to attack in certain sections, you can actually become a benefit because they're not expecting it. It's just things. It's an ever evolving gameplay. I like that. It doesn't get stuck into like a boredom of repetitiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is different and unique, even though it's taking place on the same maps. So.
Yeah, agreed. This is one of those important ones that didn't make my list. That it probably should, but it just didn't click with me. You say it feels like League of Legends. I think it feels more like Team Fortress 2.
It's very much. It's like Team Fortress 2 ripoff.
Yeah, I say which is like another one that didn't really quite get me. And I think there's enough there. Like what you're saying, like every match feels very, very different.
Yes.
Because there are hundreds of combinations of different players on the team, and that makes the world of difference in the game.
The reason I compare it more to League than Team Fortress is because Team Fortress as its whole only has, I think, like 7 characters to pick between for both teams.
Yeah.
Whereas Overwatch and League of Legends, there's so many different character combinations you can work with, and they all have different strengths. And
I think there will be more to come forever now.
Exactly. I mean, they just added a new character like a couple weeks ago, so it's always changing, and they're always doing a lot of balancing to make it, and that's cool too. I hate when people just release it, and then it's just like, deal with it.
Yeah.
So they're constantly seeing what's working and making things balanced, because you got to have balance or else everybody just gravitates towards one thing. So
that's the big thing. I played this game when it first came out and I was like, it's good, and then I didn't touch it again until December, so just last month, and they added the arcade mode, which gives you certain loot boxes for doing different types of matches, and I think that's what the game needs. And I fully believe this game would have been in my top 5, maybe like number 1 or 2, like really high up, like in a year from now, when they start implementing things like daily quest experiences, like where if you play as Tracer for 3 matches, you get more XP or something like that. Like, you know, things that like Heroes of the Storm does, like that Blizzard has already done in their other games. Like, I think once they start implementing things like that, that's when my hooks get in. When I have these small little tasks to knock off, that's what gets me.
And I see it getting there. And that you brought up, you know, it is Blizzard. That's another big I think this game is going to have a lot of longevity.
Oh, yes.
Another beautiful part of it. You buy the game, you fucking got it. You're not paying a monthly subscription.
No DLC to buy. Yeah.
You're in and you're in it. So,
yeah,
I love that aspect. So easily. Number 5 for me was Overwatch.
Fantastic choice. It, like I said, it's up. Forza just barely knocked it out.
All right, cool.
It was my close number 5.
Well, so let me hear your number 4 then.
All right. I promise.
Is this the one I said that I think is going to be your number 4?
Nope.
What
did
I say?
You didn't. Yeah, you said it was going to be number 4, but this isn't it.
Oh, okay.
This is my only indie game. Then I go big mainstream again.
I think I know what this
you
might
do because I talked about it with you very briefly. This is the Deadly Tower of Monsters, which is just a small, dumb little game that won me right the fuck over.
I think this was a free PSN game for
me. If you are a PSN Plus member, it was free in like September, October or something.
I think so, yeah.
If not, it's like $10 to do. It's from the company that does Disgaea, I think.
I love those guys.
Is Atlas?
Atlas.
Yeah, Atlas did this game. And it is what I would call the best PlayStation 2 platformer game that never existed.
Okay.
It is
The name makes me think it's a tower defense game.
No, it's not. It is a platforming game. It's like Diablo. It's like that isometric top-down twin-stick shooter with platforming. And the entire time, you're just working your way up a tower of monsters. And I say that, and it just sounds like one room after the next as you go up. And that's not it. You are going in and out of the tower. Think of like a level from Super Mario Galaxy almost.
Okay.
It is intricately made with the platforming. It's never hard or super challenging, but it's always fun and engaging. And it has this 60s vibe. It is like Plan 9 from Outer Space as a video game. It is essentially the director's commentary game. So you start the game and the director commentates over this movie he made in the 60s, and the movie is the game.
Wow.
So as you're playing, this director is commenting on the things he does. So because it's 60s based, like there are like a lot of clever puns about sexism, and like the monsters are made out of claymation. So like you have claymation dinosaurs. Like one of the boss fights, you're fighting like a giant King Kong guy. And when his fist comes to get you, like you see like a giant fist puppet and like people holding the stick, pushing it forward.
That's fucking awesome.
And then like he grabs you, and then all of a sudden you're just like a little blow up doll in this thing's hand. And it's just like these little smart, clever touches that go throughout. And it's sci-fi. It's kitschy. The in boss fight literally breaks the fourth dimension, and it's so smart. It just, my one complaint is once it does get to the end, it wraps up way too quickly. And I hope that's for a sequel to come, but it is just a small, perfect little experience if you are into any of the things I just said.
Okay.
It is, you know, it's not a big budget game. There are some little, like, your character clips through walls. Like, there's some, you know, technical things. They just didn't have the budget for it. It's like Nier. It's that kind of game where it's so good for what they were able to do with it. Like, it is fantastic. And you just wish, like, give them fucking more money. Just give them a little bit more money.
Or working to make greatness within the budget.
Yes.
Like,
yeah,
we talked about on the movies episode.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, exactly. All right,
man. I'm going to check that one out. I think I already own it, so you've incentivized me to actually play it.
And it's one where you can play 30 minutes of it, and you'll get it. If that's your thing, you're going to love the game. If not, you can walk away. That's fine.
All right, man. Well, what the hell? What's
your number
this?
4? No, wait. I started it. So you're on number 4, sir, because Overwatch was your number 5.
All right, and that was your number 4?
That's my number 4.
All right, that's what it is. Man, fucking Andre, you got me today. So my number 4, I don't think you had seen this coming, or I don't think you will be seeing this coming. I think this is my left field game, but it is one that I fucking loved. I fell in love with it. I was pretty hyped about it. I think I was the only person I know hyped about it.
Civilization 6.
No, I have actually not played that yet.
Okay. So, that was my left field guess. All right.
For me, My number four game of 2016 is the Attack on Titan game.
Oh, okay.
Giant fan of this anime. This fucking game captures the anime perfectly. This is exactly what I feel like. You feel like you're in the fucking show. It's so perfect. You zip around. It's like a good. It's like that Spider-Man 2, that good one where you zip around the city and it feels natural and you're not fighting it. That is this fucking game. It is nice. So much fun to zoom around and to fucking move around the Titans and cut the fuck out of them. You can cut their arms off, their legs off. And as you do that, you know, they can't attack you. Or if you cut their legs off, they fall on the ground and they move slower and you can get to their weak spot on their neck. It's fucking like playing the anime. It's so fucking perfect.
All right, so I am very interested in this game. I just haven't gotten around to it yet. I have questions.
Go ahead.
So it is made by Dynaforce, the people that do the Dynasty Warriors games, which I love. So I'm already on board because I like those games. But you're fighting large armies in that game. There's no armies or like minions, right? Are you just fighting big titans?
But there's a lot of titans and there's different classes of titans.
Okay.
So there are tinier titans that I think are like 2 or 3 stories tall. And then there's like mid-level titans, which are like 6 to 8 stories. And then you have giant titans, which are like 10 to 15. And there's different ones peppered throughout the levels. And, you know, it's a big score-based system, like I think F to S. Okay. So the quicker and the more that you take out, of course, the higher your score. And then that unlocks better gear and equipment you can use. It's almost RPG-esque in that, like you unlock things. And certain titans, as you see, like, as I said, you can cut off their legs and their arms. And sometimes as you're zooming by them, like their arms or their legs will have this unique icon on it. And that's telling you if you cut that off, that has a unique item that you can farm from it that will you can use it to build those better equipment. So it's got sort of this little RPG farming aspect to it. It's really hitting all of my buttons. Huh. So and here's the most beautiful part. It's got a whole fucking online multiplayer campaign. We can play co-op together if you do get it.
Okay.
Which I fully recommend because it is implemented well and it's a lot of fun. And I'm kind of OP'd at it right now, so I could just fucking carry you through a lot of shit. While you get your feet, I'm keeping you safe. Dude, it's fucking amazing.
All right.
And there are different characters you can play from.
I was going to ask if you could be, because I don't, Mikasa is.
Mikasa. There's Eren. Uh-huh. And I like to play as Levi, who is the captain of the scout regiment, who's the guy who's got like the bowl cut. And they all have like their own unique abilities and their own unique reasons to play as them. Like Eren he's got a lot of strength when he's moving fast, like from a downward motion. Okay. It's almost a one-hit kill. What I like about Levi is he's got that spinning thing that he does in the show. And that gives you a lot of boost to your attack, too, when you do that.
Huh.
It's cool reasons to play as different ones, and you can level them up separately, too. So
okay.
It's got a lot of RPG element. Fucking love this game, man.
Yeah, I could see it being like almost, what's that? In Earth Defense Force. I was like the big insect game. Like that kind of just big, lot, dumb fun.
But a lot better
playable where you can level
it's
up.
It's a lot more AAA money. Like, man, they put a lot of money behind it and you can
That's
tell.
That's good.
The other thing I really liked about this game is that I was hyped on it, so I got it day one. And for the record, this has brought us the most viewers on our Twitch channel at any one time. Twitch @ Experience Grind.
Uh-huh.
So I think I had like 350 people watching me play
just
this
for
game.
Attack on Titan, huh?
Yeah, just when it came out, because people were curious about this game, and they're like, everybody was asking, like, what do you think? What do you feel? And I was like, it was mind-blowing because, you know, even that's not a big number, but to me, to have that many people watching the stream, it was fucking cool. So
we're going to have to buy a bunch of bad games. Not necessarily bad, but like unknown games.
Yeah.
Day one when they come out, that's how we do it.
So I'm planning that for Persona 5 already.
I'll buy Persona 5 with you day one.
All right,
and we'll play through it together because I've not played any of the Persona games, but
I
that
hear
looks
a lot
incredible.
Of good things about 5. I have Persona 3 on my Vita, and I love that.
Yeah,
and
I've heard 3
Shin
and
Megami
4
Tensei,
really good.
The one where you turn into a demon and Dante is a special guest that you can get on your team.
No shit.
I think it's Shin Megami Tensei Tengu, maybe. I don't know. But that's pretty cool. But anyways, so that's my number four, man.
Very
Attack
cool.
Attack on Titan.
I like it.
Cool.
That's a good choice. I've not played it, so I can't really comment,
highly
but
recommend
it looks
it, man.
Fun to me.
If you like the anime, and this is what I told everybody who asked me, if you like the anime, you will fucking like this game.
At the very least, it just seems like a different type of game. Like, yep. At no other game do you fight giants like that.
And if you like any of the early good Spider-Man games, you will like this game. So,
yeah. Sounds good.
So let's get into your number three, buddy.
All right. Number three. I'm stick with the Xbox One train.
Okay.
And this is probably going to discredit me with a lot of people. Dead Rising 4.
I don't think that'll just... I know a lot of people that like Dead Rising 4.
Yeah. I'll tell you the reason I bought an Xbox 360 was Dead Rising. I waited. I didn't buy it at launch. I was like, well, I missed the launch because I think that's back when consoles came out and you couldn't buy them. They didn't produce a lot of copies. Like, if you weren't in line to get a 360, you couldn't get it for months. So I was like, well, fuck, I missed my train. I'm done. I'll just wait a few years. I don't fucking care. I've got a PlayStation 2. That's fine. Dead Rising came out, and I played 30 minutes of it at a Walmart, and I was like, I have to find a 360 now to play this game. It hooked me. It's the creator, Mega Man, making a George Romero zombies in a mall movie where you have free reign to do anything. Anything in there is a weapon. It's a great balance of survival and action and all this stuff. But the first one was very flawed. You had shitty fucking escort missions. The AI was horrible. The save points were not great. The time limit was stifling. All of that is gone. And a lot of people are poo-pooing on it because the time limit made it tough and challenging and hard and whatever. That's what Dead Rising is. Fuck that.
Fuck you.
They got rid of that. So it is essentially Grand Theft Auto with zombies in a mall with a character that is like Ash from the Evil Dead series. He doesn't fucking care about anything that's happening. He's being glib. Like, at one point you run into like an S&M store and he's just like looking at shit on the wall. And he's just like, what the fuck is that even? Like, he just sees like nipple clamps. He's like, who wears nipple clamps in 2000, whatever. And like, it's just these weird smarmy references that make the character likable, helps drive the story. And the gameplay is just fucking fun. Like, the leveling system is good. You have 100 levels to grind through now. You can like really tweak your character how you want him to be. And the multiplayer is good too. There is a separate campaign of 4 episodes where you can hook up with 4 other friends, and it's like horde mode with a story. And it's fascinating. It's great. I love this game. I love the absurdity. Dead Rising 2 brought in the combo weapons. So like, I'm making Blanka from Street Fighter helmets that shoot electricity at zombies. Like, you get a giant exosuit to rip things in half. All right. You make like...
And it's Capcom, so that's why you have the Mega Man and the Street Fighter.
Grand Dolph staff, which his ultimate move is the You Shall Not Pass, and it turns all the zombies into gingerbread men. Like, that's what this game is. It doesn't take itself seriously.
It's very absurd.
It's dumb and over the top, but fun. When I should be playing things for this podcast, I put on Dead Rising and just kill some zombies for a little bit.
All right. Well, I'm glad you're bringing that up because I'll bring that up again later.
Good.
As I said, I don't have a one. I will give Dead Rising 4 a shot on your recommendation. But I am one of the people.
When you get a one, I'll let you borrow it.
But I am one of the people that I was very turned off after the first one. I did not like Dead Rising 1. All the flaws that you mentioned totally turned me off of it. Because it got a lot of like, and I should like it. I like zombies. I like George Romero. I like malls, and all of it. It didn't click with me. And much like Assassin's Creed 1, I didn't give the rest of them a chance because the first one left such a bad taste in my mouth. So
that's fair.
That's where I'm at with Dead Rising.
Yeah, I'll absolutely let you borrow it. I think you'll appreciate the different path it took.
All right, man. So. I'm going to tell you my number. So we are number three.
We are still on number three.
I'm on the level. So
you had to switch it up and make me go first, and you messed yourself up.
I did. It really fucked me up. But I wanted to because I'm ready to talk about my number one game. But here we go.
Ooh. All right.
My number three game for 2016 was the, I guess it's a continuation, it's the 2016 Doom.
This was the other game that was important that probably should be on my list,
man,
that just missed number
this
5.
This fucking game did everything that speaks to me, and it did it right.
Mm-hmm.
Super fucking violent, super fucking fun. It's perfect Doom. Like, and yeah. God damn, everything is great. My favorite aspect of this game, and I know you've played it, and this will be a minor spoiler,
yeah.
But I love the fact that at the beginning of the game, you're Doom guy from Doom 1, and you have taken on this mythical thing that the demons are now scared of. Like, when, like, certain demons are like, they see Doom guy back, they're like, oh my god, that's Doom guy. And they fucking flip out. I love that twist on this lore and the narrative. It's so fucking,
Yeah.
And just the brutal kills, the fact that, you know, it works into the game, how, you know, you get different things that benefit you, either health or ammo, based on what you choose to kill these things with.
It's a tightrope act. You go into these battles, and most games nowadays, it's the cover mechanic where you take health, you start to turn red, so you have to hide and wait. This game, fuck that. You're back to classic. Like, you have 100 health to start with, and if you lose it, the only way to get it is to chainsaw people to get ammo, or to get health, you have to do a finishing, or what's it, a glory kill
they
or something?
They call it glory kills. And
which is, yeah, which are brutal. So it's just this gameplay balance of, do I go in there and rush it? I can't stay back because now my health is low, so I'm going to have to keep pushing forward.
Well, and that's what is great, too, because it's a tie-in to the original Doom, where you didn't have cover either. You have to constantly be in motion. If you're standing still, you're fucking dead. You have to be moving the entire time or you're going to get eviscerated. So it's cool things that they do it like that, but they tweak it and bring it modern.
Agreed.
And, you know, with the glory kills, I like how there's different ones based on where you attack the enemy, from the back, from the front, from the side. Mm-hmm. Just all things like that. It's all these subtle things, and it's just, it's fucking perfect. It's a great love letter to the Doom of old.
It is.
And brings it current. So
yeah.
Fucking amazing.
The level design, I think, should be talked about, too. Like, you get a little map that shows the whole level, and, like, this has secrets that are fun to collect and go all your way. Like, this should have been, like, what, a 5-6 hour game? But, like, it ended up taking me 16 hours to go through the whole campaign because I'm looking in these cracks and crevices for, like, the little Doom figures that you pick up and they go.
It's fucking great.
Like,
dude,
the old music.
It's such a love letter to original Doom.
It's fantastic.
It's my number three easily.
So. I completely agree. I love it. I love it, love it, love it. The only thing that held me back was it gets a little repetitive.
It does.
Just
it
because,
does.
Like,
but that's also Doom.
Waves of imps, and then this, and then third tier demons, and fourth tier demons. Next room, first tier demon, second tier demon, third tier demon, fourth tier demon, now fifth tier demon. Next room, first tier demon, and then you keep going like that.
My thing with it is that, very similar to Destiny, the whole thing feels so smooth and so natural.
It is.
The repetitiveness doesn't bother me because you're not fighting the controls. Sometimes you may die. But again, it's because maybe you probably stood in one place too long.
Yeah.
Never,
I agree.
It's never the game's fault. Mm-hmm. So
it's a game that, like, I, when choice with options, I was like, I don't know if I want to play. I don't know if I'm in the mood for Doom right now. But as soon as I put it in, it's like Doom for 4 hours
because
I can't just fucking stop.
It's
like,
fucking good,
it's
man.
So good.
So,
I agree. All right,
man.
Great That's choice. Cool. Great choice.
That's my number three, dog.
All right.
Number two.
Shit. So that was your number three. Okay. Wait. We might have number two'd.
Our number
same.
Two. Let's see.
We may have number two the number two. My number two, Titanfall 2.
Ah, me too, buddy. Fucking Titanfall 2. God, this game is so fucking awesome.
This was a fucking underdog, if I ever did, because I put it in and played multiplayer, and I wasn't impressed, and I was like, well, it's overrated. I might be done with this right now. And then I kept going back to playing with you guys. Now I am fully turned on the multiplayer. I think the multiplayer is fantastic.
Dude, and that's what it does. I was
it's
in
so
your
good.
Same boat, and I'm a huge Titanfall 1 fan. And playing Titanfall 2, I was like, man.
It's different. There's
what
something
the fuck?
Different
this
about
is not,
it.
This is not that as cool. But as you keep going, dude, it gets his fucking hooks in.
It does.
Have so much fun playing this with you and Andy and Casey, and god damn it. Mm-hmm. I just can't wait to get back into it now that all this holiday shit's
I
over.
I want to let you just talk about all the multiplayer, because I think I'm coming from the single player on mine, so please go ahead and just sell the multiplayer out.
As Titanfall 2, like, you're hanging, especially with your buddies, like, there's like 7 different classes you can do. You have the hollow invisible, you have a shrook, and you can throw that gives a pulse out to show enemy locations on the map. There's my favorite one I like is a speed boost that also regenerates your health for a second. This entire multiplayer system is based around speed, so everything is trying to give you things fast and keep things flowing. Matches are generally like 15-minute time limit, but they rarely ever reach that. And of course, at a certain point in the fucking game, you're going to get enough points to bring in your own fucking Titan, which is this giant robot that falls from the sky, and you're going to climb in it, and then you're going to fuck even more shit up. And there's like six
unless you're me, and in which case you die real quick and then you just curse a lot.
I don't know, man. It's just it's such a fucking blast to play because it's constantly changing and evolving. Like, as I've said before, even when I'm on games where I'm doing just fucking awful and we're losing hand over fist, I don't care because it's still a blast to play. Agreed. And that is so rare on a multiplayer game that even when you're losing, it's okay. You're like, well, fuck it, man. We're having fun.
Very good point.
So, I mean, and that's the biggest shame about Titanfall 2. It was a big sleeper. It came out the week after Battlefield 1.
And right before Call of Duty. It was right in between those 2 weeks.
And that's fucking bullshit. And not enough people have played it. And that's unfair because this fucking game is amazing for multiplayer, for single player. The single player is very fun. It's got a lot of tongue-in-cheek jokes. One I want to throw out here right now is the See You at the Party Richter achievement. So fucking perfect, man.
So have you finished the single player now?
Yeah, yeah.
All right. This is why the game is number two on my list.
It's fucking great, dude.
The single player is fantastic. And
which the first one did not have at all.
No, it didn't. And so I was kind of dubious at best when they announced a single player for this. I was like, it's going to be some rush job Call of Duty bullshit. It's not. The characters are good. I love your Titan in this. I can't think of his name.
But he's got a personality.
He does, and it's great. And when the events happen that have to happen, like, you feel for it. And this game, I told you, like, when we were playing multiplayer, like, you have to play it single player because it does things that no other first-person shooter does. And it is the best first-person shooter campaign since Half-Life 2. The time travel mission, oh my fucking God.
Yeah.
Where you have to switch between times and platform around. It's like a fucking Mario game.
It's
incredible.
It's so fucking sad so many people are still sleeping on this. Right now, go get Titanfall 2. Go get it for PlayStation 4 and you can play with me and Ryan.
Oh, absolutely.
It's fucking amazing.
It's fantastic.
You will love it. You will love it. Guaranteed. I'm not fucking lying.
I honestly do not think we are overselling this. No. This game is that good.
Yeah.
It really is.
There is only, you know, it's not going to be a surprise what my number one is at this point. But that's the only reason why that's my number one, okay? You should really fucking get Titanfall 2.
Oh, I guess I did. Okay, I know what your number one is, but that's a surprise now.
So, Titanfall 2, motherfuckers.
Yes.
Fucking get it, okay? Mm-hmm. That's really all I have left to say. You will fucking love it.
Yes.
If you get it on PS4, added bonus, you can play with me and Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
I promise you, we play this still regularly right now.
Absolutely.
Send us a message you want to play. We will be like, oh yeah, let's fucking hop on. Let's play Titanfall. Because, it happens so quickly. And you're not dedicating a massive amount of time. You can pop in, do two matches, and waste like 25 minutes. And then be like, all right, well, I'm going to go do something else. It's not going to fucking take up your entire evening.
But it might because you won't want to stop.
You will get addicted.
Yeah, you won't want to stop. It's really good. And I will say too, the multiplayer is so smart that you level up so quick.
Yes.
You get your upgrades so frequently. Like, I've played you're playing Star Wars Battlefront with me right now. It's so slow.
And it's the leveling up process. Like,
I'm sure Battlefield 1's the same way.
It is.
Call of Duty, like, you get like a new gun like every 50 matches. Titanfall, you're getting new shit like every 2 or 3.
Every time you finish a match, you're gonna get something new.
It's so good.
Whether it's a gun skin or a player camouflage skin or whatever. That's the other thing. If you get it right, even whenever you get it, all DLC is free. They are not charging you for map packs for anything. They do charge if you want to get unique skins on Titans and things like that, but you're not forced to do that. Nothing you buy gives you an advantage over anybody else. So it's a fucking great investment. You will get everything they release for this game for free.
I think this is the year that it starts shifting towards a new model of DLC.
Thank God.
No more fucking season pass bullshit. Or like Gears of War is doing, because Gears of War 4 is like one of my honorable mentions. They're also doing it, but the season pass is like, oh, you get like some dumb skin, some gold ammo, and then a bunch of boxes to level up and get like things quicker. But like all the maps, free.
And which is how it should be. You should never cut people off from playing with other people.
That's the thing. It's like, that's fine. Like, I'd pay for more maps because that's more content. Me personally. But that breaks your community into segments, and that's fucking stupid.
And then you've got people that only have the base maps, yep. And then people that only have the first base and the first series, and then people that have all maps.
So they're not going to be in the same playlist. Ever. It's dumb. It's fucking dumb.
And then your
dumb.
Friends want to get
don't
in and join
that.
With you, and you're like, well, wait, I got to buy these maps too? And then it's, no, yep. This is the way it should be done. Fucking thank you, Respawn.
Absolutely.
Fucking A.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
Final word, buy Titanfall 2.
Buy it. And like... like you said, it's getting buried. It's not like even $60 now. Like I picked up for $30 a month and a half ago.
I picked
ago.
It up for $60 on launch and I fucking love it.
You don't have to spend a lot of money no. on it. Like it's cheaper now. You'll find deals. Buy it. Buy it. Buy it. Buy it.
All right, buddy. So yeah. Number one. What is your number one? I'm curious now.
Oh, you should know what my number one is. I know what your number one is. You should
I
know
don't
what
know what
is.
Your number one is.
My number one, which will be not a surprise to our listeners, it is one we've talked about. It is Uncharted 4, A Thief's End.
Really?
Fuck you and your eye roll, sound engineer Andy.
I wouldn't have expected this as your number one.
It
okay.
is. It is.
Blown me away.
A
nice.
Series I love and a fantastic fitting into it. It is emotionally the deepest fucking video game I've ever seen. And they're doing the same kind of, all right, you want to talk about multiplayer? Like, they're doing the same thing. They're doing updates constantly. They just added a horde mode for the game that is fantastic.
Okay.
And I play now. But more so, they ended the series.
They did end it very nice.
Better than any other series has. And I love that. I love that this is one of Sony's cash cows. And they had the gall to just fucking end it. Like, of course, we're getting this Lost Legacy, like, side story with Chloe and whatever.
I was going
to
say,
but, like,
I bet
that's
you
how it should be.
I bet you
Drake, Nathan Drake, is done. He's
Nathan
never
is done,
back.
But I'm saying I bet you they give a side developer and they develop Chloe and see how that goes.
They might. But
we'll see.
I know Naughty Dog for sure is like, done. We're done. Yeah, we're going to go until Last of Us. Good. That's
fair
fine.
Enough.
That's
and
how
cool.
it should
I
be.
I hate shit that gets mired down. Yeah. And if they want to leave, mm-hmm. let them leave. Don't make them stay because then you get mediocrity. So.
Yeah, but just, again, listen to our episode to get the full discussion. I will say best performances, voice acting in a video game, the goddamn
totally
expressions and facial, like, yeah. animation is so fantastic and mind-blowing. You talk about, like, loving tribute to a video game. Like, I just threw the controller down and just started fucking clapping once Nathan Drake put the old PlayStation controller in his hand, and I started to think, like, are they going to play Crash Bandicoot 1? They're going to do it. No, they're not going to do it. They did it. And they're fucking like, to the thing, you can't use the joystick to play.
No,
you have to use
no.
the D-pad like Crash. I was just like, done. Like, this is the perfect game. And it is. It's a great ending, great characters, a great story. Nothing bad to say about this game, minus those dumb fucking mummy bombs, which that's the only thing that mires this game down. This is... I think the highlight of the year and maybe the best thing Sony's put out yet for the PlayStation 4.
All right.
So that's why. And I'll go further to say not only is it my favorite game of 2016, I think it's my favorite game of this whole generation so far.
Damn, that's a big
just
step.
For me.
All right. I enjoyed Uncharted, of course,
my
not near to the
sleep so bad
to your level. But you know, if people want to get more in depth to it, we have an entire Uncharted 4 episode that you should go listen to, you fucking dum-dums.
Dumb.
So
shame.
We're here.
Yes.
My number one game of 2016. Pretty sure we both know it. You guess it because I could not guess yours.
Are you sure you want me to guess?
Yeah.
All right. I don't have anything clever to say. It is Final Fantasy 15,
you're
right?
Goddamn right it's Final Fantasy 15. And I did not expect it to be Final Fantasy 15.
I kind of thought it might be.
when I got it, I expected to like this game, but I didn't, you know, I was still unsure about it, even though, as of course I always do, I overhype, I massively hype. I was very fucking pumped for this game, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
And it has exceeded all of my expectations. Well, as
yeah, that's the thing. It speaks to the quality of the game because you overhyped Final Fantasy and Last Guardian, one of which we're talking about
yes,
now.
Yes.
So I think it's a quality game.
God damn, dude. So here, just to give you frame of reference, I am currently sitting on 114 hours played on this game. It is absolutely fucking stupid.
This is also why I can beat 63 games in a year.
Yeah,
and
I can't. So I'm well on my way to platinuming this game. Mm-hmm. I have two achievements left, and I will have platinumed it.
What are the last two achievements?
to finish the story, the final story one.
Okay.
And then to beat the unbeatable boss in the game, which they always have, which in this game, it's an adamantoise that is literally a walking mountain. It is a mountain in the game that you've driven by many times that after a certain quest that you unlock, it stands up and it's a giant turtle and you fight it and it has like 300 million HP. If you're underleveled, the fight I've read can take like 13 hours. It's still a long grind of like maybe 30 to 45 if I'm adequately leveled.
30 to 45 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can take... It's not the worst. If I was to do it right now, it would take like maybe 3 hours to fight and kill.
So I think we can Sound Engine Andy, replay the clip in this episode where Kyle says, I don't have time for a 30, 45 minute game of blah, blah, blah. But you can fight one fucking boss in this game for 45 minutes and be okay with this.
Oh, yeah. I love Final Fantasy 15. I don't even care, man. This fucking game, it's not for everybody, I'm sure. I'm a giant, as big a fucking Star Wars fan as I am and a nerd boy I am, I'm also that for Final Fantasy. I fully admit, I don't care. I'm currently replaying through Final Fantasy VII for no reason other than I wanted to.
Did Final Fantasy 15 get you back in the mood for 7?
It did,
yeah,
to a bit, and it's also gotten me. Also, our talk of our what is it? Our
the New Year's resolutions.
Yeah, the resolutions where we're both gonna play through 9. Mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, fuck it, I'm gonna get 7 out the way. I'm actually really stoked because I'm doing better on 7 than I ever did as a kid.
Nice. Yeah, it's a lot easier when you're not a dumb teenager like I was when I played it for our podcast.
It was cool. Like I got all of Aerith's, I got her level 4 limit break and her ultimate weapon, which I have never done, and I actually used them. I did all of that on disc 1.
Yeah, I saw the Facebook thread.
It was a hell of a grind, man. It was crazy, but I mean, this podcast is all about that experience grind, and fucking grinded that experience out, and I did it. So. But man, Final Fantasy 15, it's cool. What is amazing to me and what hooked me from the beginning is that as soon as you start, it's almost nearly as open as like a Skyrim or like you are not limited at all, pretty much. There are some minor barriers here and there that are story based, but pretty much from the outset, you are free to do what you want to do in the game. You can go almost anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Explore, it seems like it's do a anything.
Direct reaction from Final Fantasy 13, where you were in a corridor for 8-9 hours before you ever got.
I think
any
that was a big
world.
Influence at the beginning for sure, because it's such a drastic change, and it's.
Sounds like it's for the better. Like not just you, but I think most people are really digging this one, and I'm looking forward to getting.
I think
it
was the top selling PlayStation. It was the top selling console game of the Christmas season outside of the 2 Pokemon games, which are $20 cheaper.
Good
and
for
are
Square.
For a handheld.
Good for
it
Square.
It was the number 3 selling game on Amazon outside of Pokemon Sun and Moon. Mm-hmm. So it has done phenomenally, and I think it deserves it. I fucking love this game. And I, you know, it, in severe contrast to what we just talked about in Titanfall, I do have the season pass because they have DLC that they've planned to release. I think at least 8 different episodes that will provide additional content, weapons, fights going on. So I was fine with it. I like that idea that they've got more in the pipeline coming down. So.
What do you think about the story fixes and changes that they're doing for DLC? Like, oh, well, we meant to put this story in like episode whatever or like hour 10 of the game. Are you going to go back and play it once they patch in?
I'm sure
all
I will.
Story beats?
I turn that same question around to you because apparently this is the same thing that's happening in Dead Rising 4, where the true ending isn't included in the game until the DLC.
It's fucking Capcom. Exactly. Capcom's such a bunch of fucking crooks. I'm not buying it.
Okay,
like,
that's cool.
I am happy with what I have for Dead Rising 4, and that's it. I'm not going to support a fucking
I love
$30
the story that I've been
pass.
Given in Final Fantasy 15. It's a little cheesy at times, but that's Final Fantasy. I really enjoy the relationship that is made between these four characters on this. It starts out as like a road trip, but there's a great... I mean, at a point where I'm past now, it gets a little... There's a time where it's a little ham-fisted and a little out of nowhere, and I will not spoil it.
That's okay.
And that's the one thing people complain about majorly about this game is this one weird turn. And when you do play it,
seems like a nitpick.
It might
not
be.
Hearing
it doesn't bother me, I could see how it bothers some people. But again, my story is also very, you know, the time I've dumped into it is my own choice. You can easily beat this game well sooner than what I've beaten.
I've heard like 15 hours and done, which is absurd for a Final Fantasy game.
Exactly. You can beat the game at like level 50, level 60. And even that is grinding. I think you can beat it at like level 40 even.
Okay.
So I'm like level 80, grinding towards 90 right now. So
gotta fight that mountain.
I will fight that mountain, and I will platinum this game.
Cool. Would you say these are some of your favorite Final Fantasy characters? Any of these?
Two of them I really, really like.
Okay.
That's Gladio and Prompto. And a lot of people don't like Prompto, but I like Prompto a lot.
The butler, kind of like the old
Ignis.
Dude? Okay.
Prompto is the younger one with also blonde hair who has the camera. He's the smaller one.
Okay.
And Gladio is the big guy with the big swords. He's cool, too. I like them all. They're all very yaoi, I think, is the Japanese term. They're very fan servicey to the women aspect.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was. I thought yaoi was specifically like guy and guy.
Be. I think it is a bit that too, and it's not implied in this game, but it could be fan servicey later. I mean,
Yowie Wowie.
That's
our new name of the podcast.
Yowie Wowie. That could be our segment.
Yowie Wowie Hour.
So I don't think any surprise to anybody, especially at this point. Final Fantasy 15, number one.
All right, yeah, that makes complete sense.
I'm really glad you and I
episode on this.
I would like to when you finish it because I didn't really want to get too in depth. So
yeah.
And I think I would really like to do maybe a full Titanfall episode two and maybe bring Andy on. So
yeah, absolutely.
I love that was both of our number twos. That's perfectly poignant.
I can't believe that. So that was perfect. Yeah.
All right, man. That's all I really got to say. 2016 was a pretty good year in video games, all in all, I'd say, though.
I agree. I did have honorable mention. So Doom and Overwatch we talked about, which are great. Gears of War 4.
Haven't played it, can't say.
Which, again, Xbox One, and I know you kind of fell off the Gear series, but was a good return to form with some really new characters and a fantastic Horde mode, which I am all about that Horde mode.
Give me that Halo 3 Horde.
Gravity Rush HD. I never played the Vita version, so when it came out to PS4 this year, I went in. What a fun, interesting, unique game that's unlike anything. It all involves you changing gravity to fight people. You literally change how your character falls into people to fight them, which is a mechanic I've never seen before and actually handles magnificently well, and it shouldn't. So I'm very excited for Gravity Rush 2 that comes out in 2017. And then finally, Rock Band Rivals, which is what I would say Rock Band 4 underwhelmed and was not great, and why we did not mention it last year at all. It is the Taken King to Destiny to Rock Band 4.
Okay.
It adds a new leveling system, a competitive thing that like really makes me want to keep playing all these old songs over and over again. It adds a story mode, which is the worst thing I've ever seen and fucking painfully bad. But it's the Rivals mode. This build a crew online with other people, play with them, and then you're pushing forward into like different ranks. So like you start off as a bronze band and you go to silver, gold, platinum, and it's like this constantly shifting. Every week they change it and update it. So it's almost like a MOBA, how you like level up and like push
and
points
you're doing
into
this
your
with
thing.
Other people.
And you do it with other people, you do it with specific songs. So like one week there'll be like songs with colors in the names you have to play to get up. So like play Purple Haze, play like Orange Crush by REM, like all these weird things that you probably wouldn't play because
and
who wants to fucking play Orange Crush by REM? Yeah. Nobody. But you will to fucking get that experience and to level your crews up. So they've done something really smart, and I think it should be acknowledged because Rockman 4 was a pretty meh release and not the return I wanted it to be. So
any other honorable mentions?
That's it. Those are the only games I played in 2016 that came out in 2016.
Did you not play that one Xbox One game where you like grind across power lines and stuff? I don't know the name.
Sunset Overdrive.
Yeah.
That was out maybe a year or two ago.
Was it? Okay. Yeah.
Sunset Overdrive is fantastic.
That's what I've heard.
And that year it came out, it would have been one or two in my list because I loved that game.
As weird as it seems, it's like one of my biggest incentives for an Xbox One.
And it's like $10.
And this dragon game that's coming out.
Scalebound. Fuck yeah, platinum.
Yeah, I was, so that's my other big reason for getting a one. And
also, Crackdown 3, whenever that comes out, I love collecting orbs. Like, just goddamn, I love running around and collecting orbs.
All right, all right, man, tight. So, that's a pretty good list, man. I like both of them.
I thought so, yeah. I thought
it's very unique to us, and man, fucking A on that number two. I cannot disagree.
I'm so happy we got the same number.
I am
that's
too,
great.
Buddy. Join us again next time when we do finish out this list with our top 10 television shows, yeah. Asterisk, also Netflix originals included.
Yeah.
So
I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of Netflix originals on our list.
I got a few.
I've got a few, too.
So that'll be it. So join us next time when we will be discussing the top television of 2016. And that will end it up with our game of 2017, which we have some information out on already.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go ahead and take this opportunity and fucking join us in this.
Yes.
You have until January 20th is your final cutoff. You say the 15th.
I say the 15th because reviews might come in earlier than that date.
So
that Sunday right before XXX.
Okay. So you have until January 15th. Get on this. Join us. We are giving out some prizes. We will be
Absolutely.
Giving out movies, and we will be giving out games, and these are not bullshits. These are going to be nice, big games of 2017.
Yeah.
I would imagine there'll be a copy of Nier Automata.
I would love that. That's actually fantastic.
I think we should totally give that away, because I have good hopes for that game, and I think it's going to achieve those.
All right, yeah, let's do that. And then what's a movie that we're both into? We'll say Nier Automata. Automata, however the fuck you say that goddamn dumb name. We'll give you a copy of that game.
Nier Revengeance.
Resurgence. Revengeance.
Yeah.
Yes. What
is
movie?
A good movie
what's
coming
a movie?
Out in 2017 that we're hyped? Or it could be 2016.
We could do Justice League. Well, might not be out by that time because that's November.
Yeah. I want it to be something that people don't have.
That's
got to be the thing. And
let's do fucking Swiss Army Man. Who has Swiss Army Man?
I'm fine
Man?
With Swiss
let's
Army
do
Man.
Swiss Army. You'll get a copy of Nier Automata and Swiss Army Man, the farting corpse movie.
Signed by us.
Yes.
Unless you are the winner and you own one or two of those, you
then
let
us know
and we'll get something else.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, that's what we're giving away. Maybe also my PlayStation 4 if I get a pro.
Yeah.
Throwing that out there.
If you want, I will put my balls on them first. there'll be
I will trace Ryan's balls in
be
a
no
silver
proof.
Marker.
Oh yeah, dude, you can do like little kids with like the
like
hand turkey.
The hand turkey?
Yeah, except like
I
it's just
trace,
all gobble.
Here it is.
It's
I will trace
gobble.
Ryan's balls with a silver Sharpie on my PlayStation 4.
I don't think that's what it's called. It's not called a gobble.
That.
Is it a gobble? What's
we
the
don't
thing
know.
On the neck?
We don't know. But that's what you will get. So fucking play this game with us. It's a digital version. It's out there. You can have it.
Yes.
And we will be promoting the fuck out of it. You will get annoyed by the time you've heard this episode.
Email it to us. Send it on our Facebook. Send it wherever the fuck
Take
you want.
Take a picture
Just
of it.
Get it to us.
Yes.
You're entered in.
You're done.
You're entered in. And free game and movie.
Ryan loves to calculate data.
I,
he will
I love,
fucking take all of that data.
I will. I take it all.
Yeah. So you will
let
be,
your data flow into
you
me.
You will be registered. So there you go. That's our game. Get in on it. It's going to be a lot of fucking fun.
Get and, in on it and get it in you.
The only incentive Ryan and I have, we're playing that. Against each other and we have a losing bracket. We still haven't decided the ultimate losers.
I really don't want to get my armpits waxed.
Well, I was going to pitch this to you. How about... I get my armpits waxed if I lose. You drink the weird thing if you lose.
Yeah, that's on point with that. I'll drink whatever the fuck gets put into anything. Over my armpits
I also had the idea of the
that's
reverse.
It's gonna itch for weeks.
Reverse
dude.
Hitler, but you would have to grow a mustache.
Uh-huh. Jokes on you. Can't.
All right then. So that's the incentive. If I lose at the end of 2017, I will have my armpits waxed on YouTube. And if Ryan loses, he will drink whatever sound engineer Andrea and I combine outside of bodily fluids.
That's the only thing. No spitter
That's
urine.
That's the one caveat.
Or
Everything
poisonous
else.
Poisonous chemicals.
Yeah. Well, I don't
Otherwise,
think.
Otherwise, like, it's all fair
Both
game.
Of us like you enough, we would
it's
not poison you. See, that's body fluid.
Body fluid.
Semen
this is why,
body
this
fluid.
That's why the words are used.
Body
Who
fluid.
Think?
So that,
right.
that includes
Here's
pee,
the thing. Here's
poop,
the thing.
Semen, spit.
I'll drink that semen, but you gotta fucking put it on air. You have to fucking air yourself milking that little dick, getting it into the cup. And then fucking fair game. Fine. You've earned it at that
point. All right. So there we go. Play the fucking game. Me and Ryan are against each other. The rest of you are against each other. So
yeah.
Get on it, and you're going to win something pretty fucking cool. Not lying. So there it is. That the challenge is out. If you don't get on it, that's your fucking fault.
Yeah, totally.
So with that, we say go fuck yourself, grind out.
Hi, this is Ryan, and if you liked what you just saw or listened to, please check us out at experiencegrind.com. Find us on facebook.com/experiencegrind, at Twitter, over at twitter.com/expgrindpodcast, where Kyle's tweeting out a lot of stuff all the time. And then you can always find us, our podcast, on iTunes, Stitcher, Twitch, or even on YouTube. Find us, just search Experience Grind Podcast. We don't have a channel yet. Stuff super easy to find. But please subscribe. We'll get there to you, make it even easier. And as always, if you like what you saw, we cover mini games and episodes every week. There's sure to be something you love. And as always, grind out.